In March this year, a paper was published in the International Journal of Antimicrobial Agents, which claimed to have done a clinical trial of the drug hydroxychloroquine for the treatment of COVID-19. A lot of media houses have recently picked up this paper and cited it as a breakthrough against the infection. But as many scientists have noted, there are a few problems with the paper. In this study, people who had the coronavirus infection were treated with a drug designed to kill the malarial parasite. Studies like these, where people are being treated with a drug that is used to treat a different disease, need to be approved by an ethical and drug safety committee before they take place. The protocol of the treatment was approved by the French National Agency for Drug Safety on March 5, 2020. The paper states that patients were followed up until day 14. A preprint of the paper was published on 16th March 2020. You see, the problem is, how does a 14-day study fit inside 6th and 16th March? It seems like they did not have the ethical clearance for the study when they started it. The gold standard for any clinical trial is a double-blinded randomized control trial, or RCT. Neither the physician nor the patients know who received the drug, that is called double-blinded, a safeguard that reduces the possibility that the doctor will treat the two groups differently. The researchers also do not get to choose what patients go into which group, and the makeup of the two groups is roughly equivalent. In addition to this, the control group and the treatment group should be as similar as possible. Patients should be of similar age and gender ratio, be equally sick at the start of the treatment, and analyzed in the same way. Only difference between the two groups should be whether the patients receive the treatment or not. The problem with the French study is that it did not follow any of these rules. The patients were recruited at different centers, but it is not very clear which patient was located in which hospital. The hydroxychloroquine treated patients were all in Mexi, while the controls were located in other centers. Here you should know that hospitals might differ in treatment plans, ward layout, availability of staff, disinfection routines. A lot of factors come into play if you switch places. This study seemed to have all the treatment patients from one hospital and the controls from different hospitals. This is the reason why we see two places with different mortality rates for COVID-19. The mean age of the treatment group was significantly higher than the control group, introducing another variable that could undermine the meaning of these results. The patients in the control group included some very young patients, ages 10 to 20, while the two treatment groups only had the patients 25 years or older. This is strange because the paper also states that patients could not be included if they were 12 years or younger. Three patients did not fulfill the criteria. The French researchers also treated some of the treatment group patients with azithromycin, a common antibiotic. Another complicating factor that was not randomized. Antibiotics have no effect on viruses. Although they have not mentioned why they used it, I assume it may prevent bacterial superinfection along with COVID-19. But even more important than these shortcomings is the design of the study, is how the researchers choose to measure and report the results. 42 patients were initially included in the study, of which 26 were in the treatment group and 16 in the control group. 3 from the treatment group were transferred to the ICU, 1 died, 1 left the hospital, and one stopped taking the treatment due to nausea. The other 36 eventually recovered, and those who received the drug cleared the virus from the system faster than those who did not. It seems a bit strange to leave these 4 patients on the paper who got worse or died out of the study just on the basis that they stopped taking the medication. This is wrong, ethically and statistically. You cannot remove data points from a study just because they did not fit the narrative. Some people have sarcastically commented, "My results always look amazing if I leave out the patients who died or experimented not work." Now to look at the clinical improvement because of the drug, they have used PCR to quantify the viral load. This is what researchers use to detect the presence of the virus in your throat. At face value, this method looks good, but it comes with some limitations. A throat swab or an upper respiratory tract swab will have an uneven amount of viral load and is not a very quantitative way of measuring clinical effectiveness. The virus could still be rampantly present in the lungs while the virus is already cleared out of the throat, and the patient could still be very sick. A better method is to use body temperature or lung function to measure clinical improvement. In the paper, it seems like they have used more than one method to look for the presence of viral loads. In some places, it tries to quantify the amount of virus in the swab, while at other places, it just tells us if there is virus in the patient or not. Also, it looks like the researchers randomly thought to replace all the ND, PCR not done, in the table from the peer print with positive test for untreated patients in the final version. Several patients in the control group did did not even have a PCR result on day 6, so it is not clear how they were counted in day 6 result. For example, look at patients number 11 and 12 who were positive on day 4 but not tested on day 5 or 6. How sure are the authors that these patients did not convert to PCR negativity? These problems make the paper inconclusive, and it is the reason why scientists across the world don't trust the results of the paper. As some people have mentioned, after all, azithromycin and hydroxychloroquine are highly tested drugs and have been in use for decades now. Then what is the problem in giving it anyway to the patients? Well, the problem is administering both the drugs at the same time causes well-known drug-drug interaction, which increases the chances of cardiomyopathy. Also, even if these well-proven drugs have an established track record, we don't yet know about that disease-drug interaction. We don't know if these drugs can be harmful if taken during the virus infection. For example, beta blockers commonly given during hypertension cannot be given to asthma patients because the drug also causes constriction of the airways. I would like to give the example of thalidomide as a drug to cure nausea that caused widespread birth defects in newborns. Had there been good clinical trials, this tragedy could easily have been avoided. Few days ago, the same group published a bigger study with 80 patients, but it also did not have any control. If only this group had done a foolproof study to look at the effect of these drugs on COVID-19, we would have clearly known if the drug gives any clinical benefit or not. To further complicate things, a lot of clinical trials have taken place that show mixed response for hydroxychloroquine treatment. There have been reports of people self-administering chloroquine phosphate intended for treating diseases in an aquarium, which has led to at least one death and one serious illness. We state that under no circumstance should an individual consume azithromycin or hydroxychloroquine or both without proper medical supervision. FDA does not recommend the use of any of the above for treatment for COVID-19 except under special conditions.